The impact of COVID-19 on child mental health has been talked about by experts and news outlets across the country. But as children and young people return to school, the question is now, what is going to be done about it? Joining us today is Elaine Hills, Green Party Councillor and Deputy Chair of the Children, Young People and Skills Committee. Welcome back, Elaine.
Hello, Anya. How are you?
Great. It's great to have you back.
Thank you.
Can you start off by telling us about the impact of coronavirus on the mental health of children and young people?
Well, the answer is kind of no, in a way, because obviously there's probably a different answer to give for every child. But the reality, you know, it's hard to capture the reality of all the different experiences that children, you know, have had. But on the whole, children's mental health has deteriorated for many people. Being isolated, being alone, being at home, not seeing their friends, hasn't had a very positive effect. I have a 14-year-old daughter at home, and she's actually really looking forward to being back at school. You know, just being an only child obviously makes it even more isolated. You know, you have to hang around with oldies like me, so it's not so fun for her. There are charities like Childline and Young Minds, and they've had a surge in calls from young people, you know, worried about things, feeling anxious and that kind of thing. And it is basically born of the pandemic. So I think there's no doubt about the fact that it has had a negative effect on young people. There've been surveys, I can't remember who it was, I've got it somewhere.
So that's a report I think you're mentioning by The Lancet, published at the end of last year. It revealed the rate of probable mental health problems amongst children aged 5 to 16 has increased from 1 in 9 in 2017 to 1 in 6 in 2020. So it's a big increase there.
So that brings it from, I can't remember, I think 11%, it's jumped up to 16%. So it is quite a big jump. And every percent is a very large number of children who have a mental health problem. So it is, you know, numbers and percentages are real people's lives, you know, we have to remember that. And also another thing that is worth flagging at the minute is a huge increase in eating disorders. At the moment, it's, what's the full title of it? I think it's Eating Disorders Awareness Week. And I've just been reading up a little bit on this. And the growth in eating disorders, it's jumped by, you know, 4 times since a year ago, the number of people with anorexia and bulimia, and they're young people and children. So it's a really serious thing and something that we need to address.
Considering how serious it is, from what we've seen so far, it seems that the government's recovery strategy for schools is prioritising academic catch-up over child mental health, making plans for summer schools, for example. What do you make of this strategy? Is it actually going to help?
Well, for me, more formal education is the antithesis of what we need. I think children need to go out, they need to see their friends, they need to play. They've been locked indoors for a long time, so taking them somewhere where they're going to be in a constrained environment when they're used to it being a holiday, I don't think that's going to really help them very much. And there's some really big issues about equality here, because the people who will take up that offer, this has been born out in studies, tend to be the ones from disadvantaged backgrounds are more, less likely to take that offer up. So then the discrepancy in achievement levels between richer and poorer children just grows. So I really think if they want to do, you know, if they want to put money into children's education in the summer, yeah, fun activities, sport, outdoor things that, you know, encourage communication and allow children to be themselves, because I think that's what they need more than ever.
It's an important point. And how did the council adapt its mental health services for children and young people during lockdown?
It was a difficult one the first time around, but we have a school's wellbeing service, and that continued to operate during lockdown. It was open every day, and over school holidays as well. And it's there to stop children in need of support slipping through the net. There was a consultation line. I know that it doesn't run during school when the children are back at school, but this was running so that if there were any parents or carers or professionals, they could, if they were concerned about a particular child, they could get in touch and get support for them. With regards to, you know, learning from home, there've been doorstep drop-offs of packs around anxiety, and also help to staff to help them deal with the extra considerations that they have with regards to watching out for, you know, how children's behaviour change can show, you know, that there might have been a deterioration in their mental health. So, I mean, there is an urgent response service as well that exists all the time, 24/7, that it's called the Mental Health Rapid Response Service, and that exists right in Hove, that anybody who needs to call it can, and there should be someone there. And we do link closely with, we have groups, advice and support services in the city, and it is quite well linked with all of the groups, and including groups for children with disabilities, special educational needs. So there are these groups, Amaze and PAC, who Amaze are correctly named because they are quite amazing, and they help support. They've been delivering online sessions for young people who you know, can't make it into school to be with their classmates and things like that. So there has been a lot going on. Obviously, it's difficult, but we do our best.
That all sounds great. And how are you supporting children and young people with their mental health now that they have returned to class?
Well, it's a lot easier to support young people when the schools are open. There are good systems and structures in a lot of schools, wellbeing services and that kind of thing. And they do their best to support children. I mean, it was actually a Green Party proposal in 2019 that pushed to introduce the delivery of more activities within schools to prevent mental health problems from developing. Obviously, preventative services are much better for children and for everybody. So since then, the council has recruited 7 extra staff into the city's inclusion support service, and that's to improve the delivery of mental health services in schools, and we've tried to put a lot of that in areas of the highest deprivation. So we work with a load of other service providers, adolescent service and youth groups, and we offer and share ideas together. There's one-to-one support offered to children by specialists. School staff have been offered training, so they are become aware in how to identify and respond to poor mental health and low self-esteem and that kind of thing. I know some schools have services in place where they ask children, I think Vondine do this, if they've identified someone in their class who they're worried about, it's, you know, they can, you know, just flag that, raise awareness up to a member of staff, and then hopefully, well, yeah, the staff will then take that further up with the child that they're concerned about. So I know school newsletters put, you know, they include things on mental health, well-being, and they put in their assemblies, they talk a lot about well-being. I know it's a really, really important thing at some schools, hopefully all schools. What else? Yeah, another thing that really needs to happen is more anti-stigma work. I think a lot of children or young people, anybody really feels embarrassed if they have a mental health problem, and really they shouldn't. It's part of being, it's a normal thing to happen to a lot of people. And yeah, there are mental health ambassadors in a number of schools, and they are people who've gone through it themselves, they're role models. So really they exist to support people who currently have, you know, issues with their mental health, and to show them it's normal, it's part of growing up. It happens to everybody, or it can happen, you know, to anybody. So surveys have been carried out to find out from young people and parents if there were any barriers to young people, you know, requesting help from mental health services, because that is important. As you say, some people might not come forward, and so they've been put out in various formats to try and capture information from as many families as possible. And these will, the outcome from the surveys will be used to find out how to get those inroads into you know, the places where the most support is needed. But of course, services are stretched. There's never enough money. And if demand increases, which it probably will, you know, it's going to be difficult, but we'll just have to see how that plays out. We wrote as a, the Children, Young People and Skills Committee, we wrote to the Secretary of State Education, Gavin Williams, asking for more money to be put into children's mental health. So let's see if that happens, shall we?
Last week, I was talking to a Brighton primary school head teacher who said that they've put their work around climate change on hold at the moment due to levels of anxiety amongst their students. Do you think it's possible to continue pushing the Green Party agenda in terms of developing young people's concern around climate change, given that at the moment young people are feeling extremely anxious about their future?
Well, I just want to start by saying that caring about, you know, the environment and teaching children about it, it's not just a Green Party agenda. It's not just a viewpoint. It's a scientific fact. So it's called a climate emergency because it's an emergency. It's something that has to be dealt with now. And teaching people about climate change doesn't necessarily, you know, it's not just about their, you know, increasing their weight, developing, you know, part of it is about empowering young people to do something about the biggest, you know, existential crisis that humanity has ever had. And children have responded really well to that. If you think about Greta Thunberg, you know, she's been a great advocate for getting up, doing something, telling us our house is on fire and we need to do something about it now, not at some point in the distant in future. And a lot of young people have got involved in climate strikes, you know, before the pandemic, of course. And they want to be involved, and they've been involved in Extinction Rebellion, and because they don't feel the government is taking the action that they need to. So children want to learn about what they can do. So I think because of that, it should continue, and it does empower children to do that. And it doesn't have to be all, you know, statistics and facts and dry stuff. It can be about, you know, responding in a way that, you know, has some meaning. I've been working with a school teacher at one of the local primary schools, and she's been, you know, I'm working on something called livable neighbourhoods, and we're developing a livable neighbourhood in Hanover, trying to stop cars cutting through the area, polluting our air, and improving the streets. So this teacher asked her students, what would you do to improve your street? And they drew pictures, and I swear, their pictures are just amazing. You've got lovely big areas with plants, with places for birds, places for children to play, little mini libraries. They've got little, all kinds of things. They're really, really imaginative. Children are imagining what they want their future to look like. So that's all tied up with teaching about climate change. So just to, you know, that was a long answer to say I think that kind of teaching does need to continue, and I think it's good for children, and it does help people's mental health to be out in the open air. These initiatives that we were just talking about is about being outside and enjoying your environment.
It's a really important point, especially at a time when coronavirus has taken a lot of the power out of children's hands, and they've been so passive in what's been going on. Empowering them in that way would be very powerful. Unfortunately, we've run out of time, but thank you so much, Elaine. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you very much, Anya.
Thank you.